Hello, I would like today to conduct a webinar about the multimodal safety on arterials and speed management. My name is Mohamed Abdel-Aty, and I am the chair of the Department of Civil, Environmental, and Construction Engineering at the University of Central Florida. And I'm also a transportation professor and recently completed a project for the Florida Department of Transportation entitled Improving Multimodal Traffic Safety for Multi-Lane Arterials. The team were Dr. Nada Mahmoud and PhD candidate George Yogan, the project managers Paul Schulzel, who is the multimodal coordinator for District 5 of the Florida Department of Transportation, and Brenda Young, who is the state safety engineer. Paul had the opinion that we would share the major findings and work on this project with different agencies, and of course, mainly Florida Department of Transportation, so that we can benefit and build on what we found or concluded in this particular project. I shared my screen, and let's talk about the project. So again, in the aspect of multimodal, we are basically mostly talking about vulnerable road users, and specifically pedestrians and bicyclists on arterials. And the study area were District 5 in Central Florida, which is about, which is nine counties. And also to look at the speeding and the speed on these arterials, because as we know, speed is a major contributor to vulnerable road users' fatalities. So we need also to discuss the issue of speed and managing speed. So the aim of the project, again, is the safety of pedestrians and bicyclists, also identifying the what are the factors that we can change or improve in order to improve this problem, also how to manage speed on arterials. Actually, we need also the exposure or the number of pedestrians and the number of bicyclists, which is not necessarily always available for all locations. So we needed to address the exposure issue. To achieve the objectives of the project, we have collected extensive big data as shown here. I'm going to go over it in detail, but basically, we used the ATSPM signal data, crowdsourced data. We used CCTVs and computer vision recognition. And we also used traffic information, mostly speed information from INRIX data, and also the crash data and the roadway features and the socioeconomic and the land use data. So we really assembled a very large data set to conduct this project. The project started again, as usual, with literature review. We looked at the different speed management countermeasures in the US and around the world. And also we looked at how we prevent or reduce the effect of or the probability of pedestrian crashes, what are the countermeasures that are used, how to protect pedestrians, etc. And you can see here a few pictures showing some of the innovative or regular type countermeasures, such as roundabouts, for example. But you can also see on the left side, that Europe has been doing well with respect to intelligent speed assistance and speed adaptation. And on the right side, you can see the beacon, the beacons such as the PHB, pedestrian hybrid beacon. There is also another type of beacons, which is the RFB, which we are going to talk about also in this project. So these are also very promising and suggested by the Florida Design Manual as well. So there were conclusions, as usual, from the literature and how we can, you know, identify some low-cost traditional speed management countermeasures. We also identified how we can reduce the speed and therefore reduce and crash reduction. Some, you know, some countermeasures are better than others. Some, you know, showed minor improvement. All this is summarized in the final report of the project, which ended, by the way, October 2022. As usual, the three E's, which is the engineering, enforcement, and education, together can have a significant effect on these types of crashes. Also, we identified the roadway features, the driver's features, the pedestrian features, the socioeconomic features, etc., that contribute to the speeding issue as well as, or the speed behavior as well as the safety of vulnerable road users, etc. And we're going to, you know, address many of these issues in the in our results. We found also that previous studies were limited to evaluating countermeasures on different types of roads, like you know, freeways, arterials, neighborhood roads, etc. But there were no studies that addressed the issue of context classification or complete streets, which is a good, you know, strategies that Florida DOT has been leading, the issue of context classification, which is classifying the roadway network into seven types based on, you know, from rural up to, you know, very urban or downtown type. We here are focusing in this project on the roads that showed most of the problems. So in this project, we are focusing on the C3C and the C3R, which are mostly the arterials in suburban areas, and the C4, which is very close to the urban areas or in the urban areas, actually. These are mostly major arterials, 4 and 6 lanes types arterials, and mostly they suffer the problems from speeding, and also they suffer a lot of the victims of vulnerable road users, VRUs. In task two, we talked about the data and what data we need to conduct or achieve the objective of this project. So we created a base map. You can see on the left side, this is the map of Central Florida or District 5. Highlighted are the arterials by type. And as I mentioned, the C3C, C3R, C4. If you are interested on what this classification stands for, you are welcome to look into the Florida Design Manual, which talk about these classifications. And there are a lot of figures and schematics so that you can understand, you know, how they are defined, or how Florida divided the roadway network into context classifications. Also, we collected the crash data. You can see crashes highlighted for pedestrians and bicycle on these arterials. Also, the exposure data, such as the average annual daily traffic and the percentage of trucks. You can see them also shown on the maps. We have access at the University of Central Florida to the CCTVs in District 5. So we are able to also utilize the videos and the images to also use it in some of the applications that I'm going to talk about now, particularly the exposure for pedestrians and bicycles, bicyclists. You can see also the Strava data, which is an app for mostly exercise. So it has a lot of bicycle routes, as well as some pedestrians, mostly, you know, people doing exercise or jogging. We understand this is not a complete pedestrian and bicycle data. We mostly use it for the bicycle part. Again, it's not a complete bicycle data, but again, it gives us good representation. It might be slightly non-random, but also we can use it. It's useful. The ATSPM data locations are mostly in Seminole County, about 350 intersections equipped with this system to evaluate signals. So it collect data for traffic volumes as well as pedestrians' call button. The data is useful in various applications. It has detectors at the stop bar. It has detectors upstream at every approach. So it's also useful in some of the analysis. Transit data is shown. INRIX speed data is shown on the three types of roads. We also used it. So now we are not only looking at the speed as, you know, general, you know, speed limits or whatever, we are actually looking at the actual operation speed, operating speed. We can look at the proportion of speeders. We can look at the highest percentile of speeders. We can look at all the characteristics of speeding by using the INRIX data. It is 5 minutes based data available to Florida DOT. We use land use socioeconomics. We also incorporated or we identified all the treatments. There are about 12 treatments identified in the Florida Design Manual for protecting pedestrians as well as speed, such as median islands, road diet, etc. We identify them and they are also included in the database. So we know where these treatments are implemented so that we can see their effect on speed, etc. I'll start with task number four before task number three, because we need to know exposure in order to be able to do safety analytics. And exposure basically is the most important contributing factor in safety models. We generally use ADT in vehicle-based models. Recently, we have started to use more microscopic type of traffic. You know, ADT is just a very rough average. A lot of the studies that look into pedestrians and bicyclists have the problem of not having the exposure data. So we have looked at the study area, and as you can see on the right side, we have you know, close to 15 or 1600 roadway segments, and we have more than 1000 intersections. So in order to go and count pedestrians and bicyclists by time of day, for example, it is really prohibitive. So we have to find a way to do that. And the way we did it is that we utilized the CCTV cameras. We collected data from 83 or videos from 83 intersections. We did a combination of video recognition techniques as well as manual counts so that we have the ground truth. And for these 83 intersections, we developed a model that relates the various factors to the ground truth or to the number of pedestrians and bicyclists. And once we validated a good model, we used this model to now predict the pedestrians and bicyclists for the 1,000 plus intersections and the 1,500 plus segments, so that now we can use all this data. So one of the outputs of this project is also the algorithm to estimate the exposure for vulnerable users. It could be used in other studies. It could be extended to other locations. It could be refined, of course, based on more than 83 intersections, but we thought this would be a very good start. So the data used for that, you can see on the right side, our computer system that, you know, identify all these boxes, colored boxes at the approach of the intersection and the intersection crossing, et cetera, are kind of the virtual loops that count any pedestrian or bicycle walking, crossing, jaywalking, etc., in these areas. So we cannot claim here that we are actually doing it for the whole arterial, because you know, away from the intersections, we did not have cameras to do that. But this could be also a possibility for the future. But at least the area and the intersection itself and the approach to the intersection is covered. And we use the ATSPM data, the crowdsource data, Strava, the ground truth, as I mentioned, from the videos, the traffic characteristics. And you can see here ADT, transit frequency, percent of trucks, road surface, lane width, block length, number of lanes, etc., and the land use attributes to estimate this model. I'm not going to go in deep in the methodology, but you can see on the left side the type of data that were used and processed. Then in the middle, various types of models were used and compared based on their goodness of fit. And then at the end, we concluded the best model, and this model was used to estimate the pedestrian and bicycle exposure at crosswalks, as well as the bike exposure along the road. So why we combine bike and pedestrians together? Because usually bicycles at intersections behave like a pedestrian. You know, either the biker would cross at the crossing zebra line like a pedestrian, or can walk and hold the bike in their hand. So therefore, it kind of, you know, we thought it's better to combine them in one model, which is basically people crossing at an intersection. However, along the road, usually the bikers are those that are traveling along the road with vehicles maybe on the shoulder or a bike lane. So this is how we differentiated and, you know, estimated the separate segment bike model versus intersection pedestrian and bike model. We did this for every hour. We estimated for every hour for the intersection, and for day and night, or peak and off peak for the bicyclist. Here, just I want to show you the comparison of the statistical measures between the different models, and you can see the last one, the XG Boost, which is a machine learning model that performed the best, and this is the model that we use to estimate the rest of the data. So here is basically two maps that shows us the final results. The left one is for intersections and the volumes of ped/bike at the intersections, and the right one show us the segments where we estimated the bikes or the bikers along these segments. So basically, the final slide about this issue is that basically total exposure was the summation of daytime and nighttime. But we can look at them separately if we are interested in a certain time of day. However, for the intersections, it was estimated hourly. So we can even look at the exposure per hour or per peak period, etc. It's more refined because we had more pedestrians and bicycles to calibrate the model. And therefore, you know, when we have more data, we can have the luxury of going into more refined time scale. So that's why we succeeded to do that for intersections. As I mentioned before, this exposure was among the factors that entered into estimating the safety performance functions for pedestrians and bicycles, and thus using it to identify the hotspots. Where are the intersections that have problems? This information, we selected the 10% highest percentile of these types of crashes, and this was provided to Florida DOT also among the deliverables of this project. Here again is just a brief idea about task number three, how we identify the hotspots and diagnose the safety issues for vulnerable road users. You can see here the different types of data that we used, the negative binomial model, similarly to the highway safety manual, were used to estimate the VRU at intersections, as well as the bike crashes along roads. We calculated the marginal effects to identify the influence of every factor or every variable and identify, the contributing factors for these types of crashes. We also use the PSI, or the potential for safety improvement, which is the methodology in the highway safety manual, to identify the hotspots. And here you can see the factors that influence these types of models. On the left side, for example, the marginal effects for ped bike crashes at intersections, you can find that there is a difference between context classification. Here, the C4 is represented, so being a C4 road indicate higher ped bike number of crashes. Frequency of transit also contribute. Exposure, which is basically combination of both the ADT as well as the ped bike exposure. Narrow lanes also contribute to more ped bike at intersections. And then some, minor effect you can see from the other two, which are basically land use type and socioeconomic type factors. For the bike crashes along intersections, you can see on the right side, there are positive factors that increase the bike crashes. There are negative factors that reduce the bike crashes. So for example, low bike exposure, of course, if we have an outside shoulder width, as it increases, so it's an outside shoulder, it could be a bike lane, but this, as this width increase, the probability of more bike crashes decrease. Block length, if we have longer block length, crashes also for bike decrease. And then you can see some socioeconomic and land use, and then you can see also the same type of context classification, ADT, pavement condition, and frequency of transit also affect the marginal effects or the safety effects. And the hotspots, as I indicated, were identified using the potential for safety improvement, which is a methodology in the highway safety manual, basically looking at the difference between the expected crashes of a certain type versus the actual crashes. As the difference increase, the potential for safety improvement increase. So you can imagine it as, a certain type of intersection, we have 100 of them, for example. What is the average, or what is the expected crashes? But the intersections that have very high number of crashes above this average would have a particular problem and have high potential of improving to bring it down to the average. It's not as simple as that, because it requires that we calculate the average using a model and the empirical Bayes method. But again, this is the kind of the concept, is that the locations that have much higher than the expected or the average are the ones highlighted. So here we highlight the 10th percent top PSI values. These are highlighted in red on this chart and provided as a base map to FDOT. And also we identified the normal as well as the, what we call the cold, which are the ones that are really below very low PSI, which means they are doing well, no problem. Among the roads that we identified were US 441 and State Road 434 as having a particular problem, and that's why we use them in a driving simulation experiment that I'm going to talk about now, to actually simulate drivers going through these particular roads. So we represent these particular roads I'll talk about in a minute. So here is the segments, same approach, the segments that had high PSI of bicycle crashes. You can see, for example, the coastal areas are pretty good. It kind of cluster the bicycle crashes in the downtown Orlando and the surrounding areas. So in summary, and let's look at the table because it kind of summarizes the text I have above here. In this table, if you have NS, it means not significant. If you have an arrow going up, it means that this increase the pedestrian crashes or the bicycle crashes. I'm sorry, here is the speed management countermeasures that were used in the models. So lane narrowing, short block, median island, these are all treatments that are from the Florida design manual that were represented in these SPF models. And you can see here that lane narrowing increase the non-motorized crashes at intersections, and short blocks increase the bicycle crashes on segments. So these are, as we try to relate the countermeasures to safety on these arterials, we try them in the models, and whatever came significant, we are reporting here. So here is an indication of the effect of some of the countermeasures that we use for speed management, but they have also an effect on pedestrian bicycle crashes. So it's good to keep this in mind, that it is sometimes a treatment is not consistent in improving everything, right? So we have to, there are pros and cons or advantages, disadvantages that we need to always to balance. Anyway, so moving to task number five is basically that we took from the previous parts that we need now to inspect some of the treatments or evaluate some of the treatments in a driving simulation environment. We have good facility of suite of driving simulators at the University of Central Florida. So here we are testing three treatments, the PHB and the RFB and the speed feedback signs. The RFB is what you can see on the figure on the right side, which is a basically rapid flashing beacon. You can see it is a sign, and then above it there is a light that flashes, and sometimes it has also a source of power, like solar. And below it, you can see the design of the PHB, which is mostly, it looks like a flashing, three flashing lights. The good thing is that it is usually mounted above the road so that it is more visible. And that's why you can find it in, you know, roads that are three lanes per direction, so the drivers can see it. These are modeled in the simulator based on the MUTCD. We also included the speed feedback sign. This is, we see it all the time on the roads that give you your speed as you are approaching it as a feedback, so that, you know, drivers are, you know, enticed to slow their speed because they see that the speed is high, for example. And then in addition to the driving simulator, we investigated seven speed management treatments from the INRIX data. As I mentioned, INRIX data give you the speed every 5 minutes on every segment, right? So now we can look at segments that have different treatments and see how the speed is changing based on these treatments. So we looked at the lane narrowing, if there is asphalt pavement, and actually it's an indication of, asphalt is usually an indication of better ride pavement, better friction. So usually asphalt is a good pavement. But of course, asphalt could also need maintenance. But in general, this is, you know, the idea behind asphalt pavement. They're also darker, so they're more visible. So there are some advantages of asphalt paint. Anyway, short blocks, road diet, median island at crossing, curb extension, on street parking. All these are identified as ways that we can use to manage speed on arterials. So these were investigated using INRIX. Here are the two roads that we concluded from the previous tasks, Alafaya or 434 on the left, and US-411 on the right. The existing design of Alafaya or Alafaya does not have a speed management beacon. So we introduced at a certain spot that we decided that this would be a good place to install a beacon. And we changed the type of beacon as different by running the experiment multiple times. For 411, it already has three PHBs at the locations identified on the map. We simulate that in a driving simulation, and we also replace the PHB with RFB to see the difference in effect in further experiments. Right? So therefore, the experiment, we have a base case, we have a case with PHB, we have a case with RFB, and we have a case with speed feedback. Right. So here are the two roads, and then for every road there are two directions, and for every scenario there are four scenarios: base, PHB, RFB, and speed feedback sign. And we are looking always as the driver is going through these signs at the we look at calculate the mean speed, we calculate the 85th percentile speed, and we also look at the maximum speed. And here, schematic to show you, of course, we did some analytics, but this would be nice also to observe here. So the first one is Alafaya. Here is where we put the sign. So in this case, it's base, and then this is an intersection. And on Orange Blossom Trail, which is US 411, we have three locations where we put the beacons, right? So if you consider the base case, you can see there is almost no change in speed. You know, the speed is shown below. The lower the speed, the darker the color. The higher the speed, the lighter the color, okay? So on Alafaya, there is no effect at the base case of speed, no changes, but of course at the intersection, you know, people slow down or stop. And then you can see here now the colors for the RFB at the beacon, and then the PHB, you can see even more darker colors. And this is not only at the location of the beacon, but a distance upstream and a distance downstream. And you can see it even more clearly in the other roads. Base, there is no changes. And then you can see the RFB, and then you can see the PHB. And you can see that the effect of the PHB in darker colors are extended a little bit more than the effect of the RFB. But still also for both of them, you can see an effect up and downstream. Okay. So you can see the conclusion on the right side is that both are effective. And you can see also that the PHB is more efficient to reduce speed. And then for the feedback sign, really there was no significant results except that the speed feedback sign had a significant effect only on the mean speed at the upstream of the sign at US 441 and downstream on Alafaya Trail, which means it has an effect only on the mean speed, and it's not consistent whether it happens as you see the sign or after you pass the sign. So this was the only statistically significant result. So there is not like a lot we can say about the speed feedback sign. But if you look at, again, the summary now of this driving simulator experiment, and we look at the table, you can see that the PHB reduced both mean speed and 85th percentile speed. The RFB reduced both mean speed and 85th percentile speed. There is no effect on the maximum speed. So people that are speeders will not really be affected. I mean, not there is no effect, there is no significant, statistically significant effect. So it might happen, but it's not enough for us to statistically conclude that the speeders or the high speed will be affected by these beacons. This is basically what we are trying to say. Now, let's move to the second part, which is now looking at the INRIX data. And in the INRIX data, we were focusing on looking at the speeding behavior at the different segments, the operating speed, what is really the operating speed. I mean, we cannot really assume it is target, speed limit or something, but what is the actual operating speed? And luckily now with the big data and all these apps, we can get the speed. And then also we looked at the difference between the operating speed and the target speed. The target speed is again a concept that is well developed by Florida DOT. What is the appropriate speed? What is the safe speed for the condition? And this is called the target speed. And the target speed is calculated based on many factors, again, highlighted in the Florida design manual. So we looked, we calculated for all the segments in the study area, the target speed. And now we want to see the difference between the speed that people are driving at different locations and what is the appropriate speed, what is the target speed. So this is also one of the analytics that we did. Again, the network is 575 miles, 1,800 roadway segments that we are looking at, which is the Central Florida or the nine counties of Central Florida. We looked at the INRIX speed, again, the traffic roadway characteristics, the land use and socioeconomic, and the variables that are related to speed management in this network. The first thing we did is that first we had to adjust the speed from INRIX because unfortunately the segments in INRIX are not the traditional segments that we usually use. And so when we look at speed, for example, we look at the segments between two intersections and we identify the speed distribution at say a midpoint, if we are getting the spot speed, or if we are doing the space mean speed, we look at the distance and the time between two intersections. The problem with INRIX data is INRIX data could be longer segments, which means there could be an intersection or a couple of intersections or more in between in one segment of INRIX. So therefore, this existence of intersections in the segment will cause delay. And therefore, when INRIX report to us the time for the segment, the travel time for the segment, and we want to calculate the speed by dividing the segment length over the time include delays. And we want the running speed or the operating speed. And therefore, we had to adjust the speed by the existence of intersection. And this is basically what we are going over here. First, this is the distribution of the number of intersections per segments on the three types of roads. And then here is the adjustment. And the adjustment, we use the model to adjust it. So how the output speed is related to the input speed and other factors, including the number of intersections. And here you can see the box plot of the different bins of speeds. It is very close. The adjusted is the red one. The original is the blue one. They are very close, as you see, but they are not identical. So it was a good step to actually adjust the speed that we are using in our analysis. Looking at the speeding behavior again, we found that there are factors that affect the speeding behavior. And the speeding behavior is basically people that travel above a certain percent from the speed limit. So if the speed limit is 40, 41, we are not considering it speeding. But if it is, I think we used a certain percent, like 10%, above the speed limit. So people that are traveling above 44 miles per hour, they are speeding. So it is little. There is a little buffer here to consider somebody really speeding. So the narrow lane width, the narrow lanes, the average block length have significant effect on reducing speeds on the C3C roads. The narrow lane could lower the speed proportion. When drivers have a shorter block length, they are more likely to be able to speed. So this is another positive. The asphalt surface could increase the speed proportion. And again, I refer to the asphalt as envisioned as a better quality, smoother, higher friction, etc. So people are more comfortable speeding on these types of roads. And here is a kind of other conclusions, the lower speed limit increase speeding behavior. So if we have unrealistically low speed limit, people will exceed it, and then we consider them speeding. So this is on all types of roads. Raised median increase speeding on the C3 type roads, which are mostly the wider, higher speed roads, like six lanes, arterials, etc. Existence of outer shoulder width increased speeding behavior. So if the shoulder is wide, people are more comfortable, they tend to speed. Higher number of lanes increase also speed. So the more lanes, the more people would likely speed. When we looked now at operating speed, so this kind of a second analysis, so the first was speeding behavior. The second one now is the operating speed. Again, we adjusted the distribution of speed based on the intersection issue and the segment, as I explained before. And you can see that the distribution, follow, but a little bit different. The speed is a little bit shifted to the right, the speed distribution, because when you remove the delays from the intersection, then really the speed is a little bit higher than we think when we look at INRIX without accounting for the delays from the mid-block intersections or the mid-segment intersection. And here is a model that looks into the factors that influence the operating speed. And basically, on the right side, in the left side, they are summarized, but on the right side, basically, you can see all the factors. And if they are to the right of the zero here, it means they increase the operating speed, and the factor reduce the operating speed if it is on the left side or negative. What I would like to point out to is the red box, because the red box here shows the treatments or the factors that we introduce to reduce the speed in the model. So this is an actual empirical data from the field. So you can see that raised median will increase slightly the speed on a model that includes all the roads and a model that specifically look at the C3 arterials. You can see also the asphalt road indicator. You can see that the narrow lanes below 12 feet. You can see the log of the average block length. So the block length also, as it increases, the speed increase. And then the curb extension reduce the speed in the C4 model. So again, there is some consistency between the C3 and the C4 models, but there are some differences between both of them. Anyway, so I just mentioned that. So this is the factor that affect the operating speed. These are the typical traffic and geometric factors, like the shoulder, the daily transit frequency, the ADT, etc. But really the ones in the red block are the ones that are related to what we are doing to affect the speed, which is the countermeasures or the treatments that we are working on in Complete Street and other Florida design manual recommend them for controlling the speed. Now let's look at the third analysis, which is looking at the difference between operating and target speed. And as I mentioned, we have calculated all the target speeds for all the roads. And now the model that we are, so we process this data, and the model we are looking at, again, the difference between the target and the operating speed. So this is the dependent variable, a difference between two speeds. And the you can see a simple map on the left side that shows you if the speed difference is greater than 5 miles per hour, it's identified in red. If the speed difference is within 5 miles per hour, plus or minus, it's identified in green. And then if the speed difference is negative, it's identified in yellow. So basically negative means that the speed on the road or the segment is less than the target speed. If it is red, it means above five, the difference is more than 5 miles per hour. So there is a bigger difference between the operating and target speed. So what influenced that? You can see here also a diagram show where is the target speed and where is the speed limit on the different roads. And this is just you know, part of the network just to illustrate how usually the target speed is lower than the speed limit. So based on the developed mixed logic model, some countermeasures could be implemented to reduce the difference. So reducing the speed limit will encourage people to reduce their speed, which means they can become close to the target speed. Reducing the inside shoulder width, constructing curb and gutter to the outside shoulder type, reducing the average block length, increasing the proportion of shared path, increasing the width of the sidewalk, installing more signalized intersections so it disrupts more the speed. We also we have also seen a difference in the difference between posted the target speed and operating speed day and night, which means there are many locations where the speed is actually around the target speed or below the target speed, but at off-peak or at night, the difference is big, which means the problem of speeding is not necessarily during the day when we or during the peak hours when we have congestion and people are forced to drive slower, but when the people are free to drive, you know, flow speed, free flow speed or higher speed, they tend to do that. So if we want to control the speed, there might be also not only only the geometric type or the physical type of countermeasures, but we might need the electronic type of countermeasures, which is basically, you know, either enforcement or variable speed limits. And this is a discussion that we had in a previous presentation. We know variable speed limits is a good strategy on freeways. We are not sure if it's good on arterials. But maybe if it's a regulatory sign and it's all only changed once a day and not, you know, changes continuously, maybe we have some compliance with this type of speed. But this is a discussion to be made. So in summary of the speed analysis, we can see here, I think this is an important chart here. Again, you can look here at the different speed management strategies on the left. And this is from empirical data. And this is based on the INRIX speed analysis. The evaluation matrix is basically the operating speed, the 85th percentile speed, the speeding behavior, and the difference between the target and the operating speed. So we are looking at three elements. And on the right side, you can see the C3 roads and the C4. And again, NS is not significant. The arrow going down, it means it is reducing speed. Okay, so you can see lane narrowing reduce the speeding behavior on C3 roads. Short blocks reduce the operating speed and the speeding behavior on C3, and reduce the difference between target and operating speed on all types of roads. A non-asphalt pavement would reduce, actually this is non-asphalt? Non-asphalt, right, because we said asphalt encourages speeding, so non-asphalt is the opposite. Would reduce on the C4, the 85th, and would reduce the speeding behavior on all roads. And then finally, the curb extension would reduce the 85th percentile speed or the operating speed on the C4 roads. We were not able to observe use the factor for on-road, for on-street parking and road diet in these models. And we were able, they were not there on the C3 roads. And they were not significant, although they are there, but they are not significant on the C4 roads. All right, so now we took all these results and designed a new driving simulator experiment that now would look into everything, right? Because, you know, there are some factors that we studied using empirical data. There are some factors that we studied using driving simulator. There are factors that we did not really, were not able to observe or reach a significant conclusion. So now we have a study, a driving simulator study that looks into all the factors, okay? So, so here is the summary of the results that I showed so far up to this point. So now the factors that we were not able to address, we took into the driving simulator. And this was task seven. So seven speed management strategies that we will use now in the new study. Four treatments, PHB, RFB, lane narrowing, and short block. And three treatments that we were not able to do before, which is the roundabout, on-street parking, and street trees. And the idea behind trees is that there is something closer to the road. And the idea is to make people slow down because they feel, you know, the side of the road is not open, but it's a little bit narrower with existence of trees or something on the side of the road. All right, so here you can see the list of the seven factors that we are addressing. What is the evaluation target, whether it's speed or vulnerable road user safety, the type of roads, the speed limits. We changed also in the experiment the speed limits, so we are not looking at a consistent speed, we are looking at different speed limits. For the C3, we're looking at 40 and 45 and 50 miles per hour. For the C4, we are looking starting from 30, 35 and 40 miles per hour. And this is based on, you know, what's existing really in the field. And then the evaluation measures are the mean speed, the 85th percentile speed. And if the target is the safety, we are also looking at surrogate safety measures, such as driver's yield rate. Here are some pictures from the simulator. So you can see here are the beacons, the roundabout, the trees, and the parking. So this is how it looks in the simulator. Again, we used our simulator. We have good capability. This shows you three simulators that are connected, but actually, you know, this was not really used in this particular study, but, you know, just show you the setup of our UCF SST lab with this. We have also another simulator in another lab, it's a mini sim simulator. Anyway, so in order to do these experiments, we built the two context classifications, C3 and C4. And here is some information about the experimental design, the different factors and the levels of every factor, and then what we are evaluating. So this kind of, I'm repeating what was in the last table. And the conclusions, basically, after the analytics that we did, so there are different, you know, statistical analysis that we did on this data. And basically what we conclude here is the following. PHB effective on all types of roads for the mean and the 85th percentile speed. The RFB, same. Lane narrowing, we did not find significant results in the simulator, but this might be difficult to observe in the driving simulator. But we did observe some effect in the empirical data, as I reported before. Short blocks was effective in C4 roads. Roundabouts was effective in all types of roads in reducing speed. On-street parking reduced the mean speed on the C4 roads. And the street trees did not show really any effect or significant effect. So from an implementation point of view, we are seeing a good substantial effect of the lane narrowing, the short blocks, the curb extensions, and both PHB and RFB beacons. We might suggest, again, as I mentioned, the different posted speed by time of day in order to bring the speed closer to the target speed. We see the merit of the concept of a desired operating speed or target speed. I think that's a good strategy by DOT. And I think DOT has always been pioneers in many of the ideas in safety, ahead of many of the other states. We did publish extensively from this work in multiple of the known journals like TRB, ASCE, Accident Analysis, etc. We think the future, we're actually having a project currently to evaluate the mid-block pedestrian signals. Again, it's an FDOT project, but it is the federal highway that want to evaluate. And since Florida, again, is always pioneers, we have 15 locations in the state currently under construction to shift from RFB or PHB to the MPS, or locations that has no pedestrian crossing, and then MPS will be introduced. So therefore, we have a really very nice condition where we can evaluate if MPS is better than either PHB or RFB, or better than nothing, basically, to, you know. So we have all conditions of introducing MPS. And MPS is, it looks like, you can see it on the figure here. It looks like a traffic light, regular traffic light. It just have a flashing red phase where a motorist can, after stopping, proceed carefully. And the idea is, while we are protecting pedestrians, we are also don't want to disrupt traffic very much and reduce the efficiency of the road. So the idea here is that, or the expectation is that, they are as effective as PHB and RFB, but maybe from a traffic efficiency point of view, they are slightly better, or they reduce the delays better. So this is what so we are looking into a lot of measures, and we are using computer vision recognition here. But basically, we are looking at surrogate safety measures. We are looking at traffic efficiency measures. And as I mentioned, 15 treatment sites, eight new, one already have RFB, and six have already PHB. And we are looking at, you know, like kind of a before after analysis of what will happen. So we are collecting data, as you can see, using a computer or cameras. And then we are processing using machine learning in order to determine the surrogate safety measures between vehicles and between pedestrians, the yielding behavior, the gaps, the delays, pedestrian behavior, driving behavior, etc., at the mid-block crossing. We are collecting data 3 days, including weekend, 2 weekdays and 1 weekend, because some of the locations might experience more pedestrians on weekend. So we are doing that on the left side, and different times of day, 4 times of day, peak hour, off peak, afternoon peak, evening, etc. And not really evening, but, you know, close to sunset, because evening, you know, the camera will not, you know, the vision, unless there is good street light, we cannot do really evening camera data collection. You can see here, for example, one of the sites, the trajectories from the computer video processing of the pedestrians, which are all the red dots, as well as the vehicles, which are the blue. So you can see also that the majority of pedestrians are at the crossing, but you can see a lot of also the pedestrians are not really crossing properly. So there are a lot of pedestrians, of course, on the sidewalks, but there is also some that are kind of crossing in diagonal or a little bit jaywalking. Anyway, so this is the idea. Here I'm not talking about the current project. I'm talking about an extension. It's not really an extension. This is a separate project. But I think in the future, when we talk about the different treatments, MPS would be one of them. Hopefully, if we find it in this project to be promising. Also, during the work on this project, we discovered that there is no there is not a valid study for the CMFs or crash modification factors of RFB. If you go to the CMF clearinghouse, you're going to find a very weak study or maybe a couple of weak studies, two-star rating, very limited data, etc. But we have 154 sites in Florida that has RFB. So we thought, okay, I mean, we owe it to the state and to the literature that we actually do a proper study with a good sample of the effectiveness of RFB. So we did, as you can see here, the treatment sites and the control sites, and we did, you know, a before after study using crash data here. This was not part of any project. It just I wanted to show you this result. And we did an empirical Bayes method before and after an empiric and before and after with a comparison group. And here are the results. And they are very, very impressive results and very significant also. You can see that the CMF is 0.31 for total pedestrian crashes, which means RFB reduces pedestrian crashes by 69%. And when you look specifically at fatal and injury crashes, it is 70%. So we're able to prevent 70% of the fatalities of pedestrians by having an RFB. So that's a very significant result. And you can see here the standard error are very low, of course, because we have a very good sample size and it's a very significant result. So this would be the first study in the country that looked at a valid sample, a good sample, and strong results of the effectiveness of RFB. The other study that is in the work, I think, by FDOT, still not finalized, and this is led by the safety office and Brenda Young in Tallahassee, is basically extending the work that we have been doing for pedestrian safety by adding some of the driver behavior, some of the human factors. As we are expanding and looking to corridors and complete streets and all this, we typically have been looking at the physical side of it. You know, what can we do to reduce speed or protect pedestrians? What, you know, but how about the human factor side? What does the driver see? How does the driver react, for example, when they see pedestrian or a group of pedestrians or pedestrians near the road or see the face of the pedestrian or see, you know, there are so many factors that mostly can be identified from an NDS type study, naturalistic driving study, that will give us the attention, what would cause the attention of the driver and the behavior of the driver so that we can incorporate in our design. And all what we presented so far, how does the driver side enter into how we design a better roads, more forgiving and more acceptance to the multimodal aspect. So this is kind of a very, very general, you know, I put here some points, but this is a very general idea. The project did not start yet, so we are refining it, and hopefully this would be a very welcome addition to what we presented so far. So with that, I thank you very much for your attention. I hope it was you know, useful and presentation, and I'll be happy. I'm sorry I did not include my email, but my email is m as a Michael.Aty, the last part of my last name, A-T-Y, at ucf.edu. Or you can contact the project manager, Paul Scholzel. And also the full report should be posted shortly on the research office website for Florida DOT. Thank you very much and have a great day. We'll talk to you later. Thank you.